American single malt.
This was a very interesting poll for us to put up because on one hand, I'm thinking, well, it's American single malt, and like we've been winning, you know, best single malt in the world occasionally, and you're doing some amazing stuff.
Is it easily available?
But though it's not easily available. So it's kind of the entire idea of a classic whiskey that lives in the middle of the category. That entire idea rests very heavily within the ability of you to actually have people experience it. How developed is the American single malt category right now? Is it fledgling?
Fledgling is the wrong word.
Okay.
It's past fledgling.
Okay.
Right? It's like a freshman or a sophomore in college now. It's still growing.
Right.
But it got big enough and strong enough and loud enough.
Yes.
They were able to change the rules.
It's an evolving category, which is very exciting. But at the same time, the most quintessential, the epitome, the core, the center of the category, not necessarily your favorite, but what is the most representative of what a category is all about.
Get some glasses.
What's number five? Well, what did the people vote up that is readily available that you can get your hands on?
No. Totally not possible. They voted up our whiskey, which is only available in a 50 mil, and we only have like 100 left in the world.
Okay, so.
And you can't buy it except here at the tasting room.
All right, so thanks for doing us a solid. But it is embarrassing for our single malt to be such small supply.
It does
supply.
Not belong on this list.
No, it does not.
This is a pity win.
But I also think, man, if more people had been able to experience single malt, this never would have showed up on the list.
Mm-mm. This is a peated malt, right?
Yeah, this is Irish peat.
Irish peat, Maris Otter grain. This does have that quintessential butterscotch times 10.
Yes, it's very butterscotchy.
It's really young. Because it's Texas, it's really freaking dark.
Let's move on, because this is going to look like we're pushing our own
stuff. I just want to take a sip and say toasted marshmallow.
Okay, and we can't sell this in here, so.
You see what I mean? Slightly wood smoked toasted marshmallow.
We won't talk about it. It's our own shit. We can't. It's fine. It's the best whiskey. No, it's fine.
What was number four?
So the next one voted up on the list
of American single malts,
Ardbeg. You did it. Came in at number four though. Like to truly flex the power of the Ardbeg cult.
Should have been number one.
Yeah. What are you doing?
Weak.
What are you doing?
Weak.
Number four. What is this? Like, I appreciate the wolves, that is funny, but embarrassing to come in at number four.
Yeah, don't start a race you can't win. What are you doing?
Oh, hey, wow.
All right.
So, we have Westward American single malt.
Oh, yeah.
Westward.
Now, here's the
American
thing. I'm seeing this show up more and more.
Okay.
Now, I don't know, like, how accessible it is, really, but I'm seeing it more and more in bars.
Okay.
I'm seeing it more and more in retail shops.
Yeah.
So I think their distribution is growing.
Yeah, the category of single malt is exciting to me because I still think it's relatively early days.
Mm-hmm. I think what we're finding is the Northwest has really dominated the single malt category.
Yes.
In the way that Kentucky dominated bourbon for a long time. Like, a lot of my favorite malts are coming out of the Northwest.
There's a chocolatey nose to that.
It's just a damn good malt.
It's like a dark tea, chocolatey, sweet malty, some honey in there.
This really is a hot cup of PG Tips black tea with one of those chocolate biscuits that has like cookie on one side and the chocolate layer on the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. I'm going in.
Oh, and it's zesty and pepper and...
Ooh, what's the proof?
Oh,
that is up there. What is that?
62.5.
There we go.
Bazinga.
There we go. No, that's...
This is a single barrel that they called Midlife Crisis.
Wow. That is really nice stuff.
Oh.
All right, Daniel, number three.
Westland
American Oak Single.
And they sort of have a core range. They have the single malt, the sherry cask, and the peated. I chose the sherry cask.
Yeah.
Because the sherry cask malt is not well represented in America. I fucking hate their lids. This is one of my all-time favorite malts.
The cap?
Yeah, but this cap adheres like glue, man.
Okay, all right.
But the whiskey is so freaking good that it overcomes the cap, and I love this malt.
Oh, come on.
A slight nutty coffee note.
Yeah.
And then all of the deep fruit sherry, that slight sulfur hint, fig.
So here's the question that I'm posing to you. American single malt, considering that in Scotland, where they have had plenty of time for the single malt category to mature and develop.
Right.
There's like many distinct regions that are recognizably different to even go in with the premise of American single malt.
It's like kind of pick one scotch out of all Scotland.
I know, scotch. But it's such a fledgling. I'm gonna say the word fledgling. Do you know the age statement on the oldest single malt available?
It's not gonna be more than, no, I don't actually, but there's no 10-year-olds. There are 10-year-old distilleries, but they're not selling any 10-year-old malts yet because it ages so much hotter and it gets more tannin. So they're all trying to find ways to keep it in the barrel longer right now.
Stranahan's is the oldest, and they actually have a 10.
Do they have a 10?
They have a 10. Stranahan's.
How have we not gotten our hands on that?
The oldest in the category is 10 years old. So yes, this is a young category.
Okay.
But is that youngness presenting kind of like a uniform expression of single malt? I would say even at this early of a stage, the answer is no.
No, there's all these varieties. Yeah, I mean, we were about to try another one that's quintessential of a whole other part of the US and tastes totally different than this. Mm. Now,
I'm waiting for it. Oh man.
It's just so good. It's just so good.
It's the nuttiness.
Yeah.
It's like a kind of a coffee nutty.
Columbia roast finish. Specifically.
And the finish.
Yeah.
Thank you to NordVPN for supporting the channel. This is a virtual private network. It sounds kind of technical, but it's actually very simple. You can imagine it as like a tunnel that connects you virtually to any part of the internet, and only you can see that. So it's super, super secure, and it's very simple. You can use it on your mobile devices, on your laptops, what have you. Now, the most practical thing, the thing that I'm using this for regularly, is to be able to get onto your streaming platforms, your Netflixes and whatnot, and unlock, finally be able to view what they can see in other countries. NordVPN, this is my secret weapon to get access to not only entertainment, but information, to knowledge. People ask me all the time, Rex, how did you accumulate this vast, vast fortune? You gotta play the guac market, specifically the avocado futures. That's where the real fat stacks are.
Yes, hello. Thank you for this opportunity, Mr. Guacal. I won't let you down.
Hey, listen, it's time you learn something, kid. Everything. All this, the economy, the government, media, next day delivery, you boo-boos, TikTok dances, it's all a shame.
You mean it's...
Yeah, the party's over. Civilization's days are numbered. We're stockpiling on the one thing that people can't live without.
Guacamole?
Millennials are the future. And those twitchy screen junkies will always be addicted to, think about it.
Avocado toast. Oh my God, you're right.
And when it all falls apart, I, Gordon Guaco, will reign supreme as the king of the creamy green.
You are like a prophet.
That's right. Guac is good. Welcome aboard, banana.
Still Brianna.
Yeah.
Woo! God, so dumb. Definitely worth checking out. There is a 30-day money-back guarantee just to try it out and make sure it's a good fit for you. There's no risk. If it doesn't work for you, don't worry about it. You go to nordvpn.com/whiskeytribe for a huge 2-year discount and 1 month free.
What came in above the Pacific Northwest might be a little more quintessential than what ended up as number one.
Okay.
It's the Colorado, it's the Stranahan's. We're talking about the 10-year-old, yes. Yeah.
10-year, you know what though? The category, I don't think has developed enough to have a core meaty center yet. But I think if you were just going for general single maltiness in America,
this has more of an overlap with Speyside and Highland Scotch.
Recognizable single malt categories from other countries, yes. Yeah, it's a hell of a whiskey.
If you knew what single malt was from other countries and you were introduced to this, it wouldn't be a leap.
So on the nose, there's malty vanilla.
And pear and honey. Honeyed pear. No, peach. Honeyed peaches.
It's like a not fully ripened peach. Mm-hmm. It's not slopping the juices around.
Ah, and then there's that malt, musty forward grain present. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like it. The American single malt community is a small community.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of overlap in working together, in collaboration, and process collaboration, and discussion of how to do things. And these guys are friends, but these guys are also our friends. This is Balcones up in Waco.
Yes, they are.
Who recently stole our distiller.
No, they did. But we stole a lot of, that's not public knowledge.
By the time you see this episode, Emma will have been there for a month and wearing a wire the whole time. This is Balcones, and I specifically chose High Plains.
Okay.
Because I wanted to show you what happens to the Balcones malt. Because
what was voted up as
Balcones Texas single malt.
This
is the Balcones Texas single malt.
Okay.
But it's only Texas barley.
Oh, that is nice.
But
notice, this is a big, thick,
big
rich,
and beefy.
Yeah.
Black tea, honey.
Some super ripe fruits.
Yeah, it's almost apricot, but it's so dark, it's more of like if you glazed an apricot with honey
It is a glaze, mm-hmm. Yeah. Almost that caramelized sugar quality.
And then there's that really spicy note that makes you feel like the burnt edge of brisket.
So this has all the way from like the bassy, hefty flavors all the way up to like a really light, bright, fresh, almost a green grape skin.
Yeah, and then you taste it and that's where all the lightness is. Mm. And the palate, it's all those light citrusy notes. Totally different than that Westland.
Very different.
But so the entire, still in the category of single
the
malt.
The entire premise of the quintessential American single malt, mm-hmm. I don't think that is a reasonable premise. I think this episode's a lie and you should burn all of this down.
I think we need regions like Scott.
I do too, but yeah. I also think frustratingly, it's so early in the development of the American single malt scene that there's not enough there for distinct regions to be obvious yet.
I will say I think there is an overlap in the Northwest.
Okay.
And I will think there's an overlap of Texans.
Okay. And then the question becomes, why is it such a young category? And my interpretation of the reality is the American single malt category in and of itself is just kind of like amorphous until very recently. What is American single malt now?
Well, originally it was 51% malt, just like bourbon 51% corn, rye 51% rye.
Yeah, but it's not defined.
All the makers
enough.
Were focused on American spirits, bourbon, rye, right? And wheat. And to have a category of malt where it didn't even have to be matched the category of the rest of the world, mm-hmm. there weren't a lot of players in that game.
Right.
But in the last decade, you got a bunch of craft guys showing up
who
are all heavily influenced by the UK, mm-hmm. with Ireland and Scotland whiskey where it used oak.
Yeah.
And it's a very clear definition of all barley,
yes.
used oak, one distillery.
Yep.
So recently they created the American Single Malt Commission, mm-hmm. which got together to say, let's create guidelines on American single malt, mm-hmm. that will be recognizable by the rest of the world.
Yeah.
That's the key.
Yeah.
Right? That will be recognizable single malt, mm-hmm. by the rest of the world who thinks they know what single malt means.
Yeah.
But they don't want to limit innovation.
Mm, thank you.
That's the hardest thing when you're coming up with guidelines. How do you create guidelines but not shut down innovation?
How are you specific to where there's clear rules to play by, but how do you not be so restrictive that you're never doing anything new or interesting?
So they followed something very similar to Ireland, which is effectively all barley, one distillery, oak. That's it.
Not even specified
aged
that it has.
Oak.
It could be new, could be used.
Could be used. There was just size limit, like under 700. Liters.
Which is a huge barrel.
Which is huge, yeah.
Yeah.
But that's fine. That's also the size limit for a bunch of other countries.
Okay. Speaking to the point that we've made a couple of times, the number one result, this barely inched out Balcones single malt whiskey. Barely. Mm. But more people than any other said, I don't think I've even had American single malt.
Yeah, see?
Dude.
That's a thing.
Dude, and if talking about exploring whiskey, I think if there was a category in American that is just doing some stuff that you need to try, it's American single malt.
And I think it's cool that even our community was like, hey, let's get into American single malt as the first thing we ever
did. Oh, in the Patreon, people voted up, what's the first thing we should do? Single malt, let's do it.
So that's the number one.
Okay.
Balcones has won the quintessential American single malt.
I'm not butthurt about it because I don't think there is any real meaty center of the category yet. But
I could see how all of these could have been in that same place.
And I think you and I both agree that this list is likely to be very different 5 years from now. Hopefully
maybe
there's some maybe some distinct regions start to become apparent. I know we get things out of California, it's gonna be different than what we get out of Colorado, the Northwest, Texas. Who knows?
On the 12 days of Texas whiskey.
You want to know what Texas whiskey is all about?
12 hand-picked distillers each contributed a single barrel of their best.
So you have a cask strength exploration of Texas whiskey.
Jank. Because supply chain issues mean this is the box we could get.
Olive oil.
Because the regulations around shipping whiskey are
a benediction for the great whiskey spirit.
Because you whiskey explorers will be met with trials and tribulations as you explore single barrels across the categories of
power up malt whiskey, bourbon whiskey, rye whiskey, wheat whiskey.
Hey Daniel, is the bottom graphic showing us the placement of the 12 whiskeys inside the box?
Maybe.
Shut your filthy hole. Did you hear that? It's the Cosmic Bunghole. He's the speaker for the Whiskey Chod.
Oh, Cosmic Bunghole, what holy message from the supreme and glorious Whiskey Chod have you come to share with us?
The magnificence! It's too intense to behold!
The power is unfathomable!
Shipping soon-ish.